Thank you. name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Welcome you to Mass on this, the third Sunday in ordinary time, year B, Sunday which Pope Francis has designated as the Sunday of the Word of God. And we're offering this Mass to the people of the parish. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed.
The word of the Lord was addressed to Jonah. "Up," he said, "go to Nineveh, the great city, and preach to them as I told you to." Jonah set out and went to Nineveh in obedience to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was a city great beyond compare. It took 3 days to cross it. Jonah went into the city, making a day's journey. He preached in these words: "Only 40 days more, and Nineveh is going to be destroyed." And the people of Nineveh believed in God. They proclaimed a fast and put on sackcloth, from the greatest to the least. God saw their efforts to renounce their evil behavior, and God relented. He did not inflict on them the disaster that he had threatened. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. John had been arrested, Jesus went into Galilee. There he proclaimed the good news from God. "The time has come," he said, "and the kingdom of God is close at hand. Repent and believe the good news." As he was walking along by the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net in the lake, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you into fishers of men." And at once they left their nets and followed him. Going on a little further, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. They too were in their boat, mending their nets. He called them at once, and, leaving their father Zebedee in the boat with the men he employed, they went after him. The Gospel of the Lord. "The Bible is the Word of God" was the first essay I had to write when studying for my theology degree, when in formation to be ordained a deacon. And it's appropriate that on this Sunday, designated as the Sunday of the Word of God, that we reflect on the importance of the Word of God in our lives. I could read an essay to you, but I won't. I didn't get a very good mark. At Mass during the day, on Christmas Day, the second reading is from St. Paul's letter to the Hebrews, and it begins, "At various times in the past, and in various different ways, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets. But in our own time, in the last days, he has spoken to us through his Son." We are reminded that the Bible is the Word of God, and Jesus is the Word of God made flesh. Pope Francis, in his apostolic letter instituting this Sunday as the Sunday of the Word of God, said it was to be devoted to the celebration, study, and dissemination of the Word of God. Perhaps the emphasis might be on that last word, dissemination. But we can't do that if we don't understand, and hence our need to read and understand the Bible. By that, I don't mean heavy exegesis, but listening to the Word of God and listening to what God is saying, and in particular, what he's saying to you. That psalm today, Psalm 24, is a beautiful psalm. The first verse, to remind you, "Lord, make me know your ways. Lord, teach me your paths. Make me walk in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Saviour." We all want to get it right, but through our human nature, we don't do that. But we have to remember that God is there for each and every one of us to guide us and help us. He wants us to get it right. One of the things that we're told and we need to constantly remind ourselves is that baptism and confirmation of the Spirit have made us all into messengers of God, messengers of God's word, because of the grace of hearing that we have. We're told that we must therefore be bearers of the same word, in the church and in the world, by the witness of the way we live our lives. We tend to read or watch things that interest us, don't we? If we have a particular hobby or interest, we read up on it to see what's the latest developments are in relation to the hobby. And quite often there are publications that are regarded as the go-to for a particular subject. For instance, some of you might remember Fly Fishing by J.R. Hartley, the advert years ago. We feed our thirst for knowledge on a subject by reading. Perhaps we therefore have to ask ourselves whether we regard the Bible as our go-to book. It's where God reveals himself to us, and where Christ, through his teachings, tells us what we need to know how to live our lives the way that God wants us to. Then, having done that, perhaps we need to ask ourselves, how good a knowledge do we have of it? How often do I pick it up and read from it, like I do in my favourite recipe book, or manual, or gardening book? In these modern days, perhaps we ask ourselves, have I got it downloaded on my phone, or iPad, or tablet, so that I can dip in and out of it, like I do the other books I've got on that? Remember, each time we come to church to celebrate Eucharist, we dine at the table of the Word of God, as well as the table of the Eucharist. The Church teaches us that when a sacred scripture is proclaimed in the liturgy, it is Christ himself who is speaking to us. He is present in his Word, since it is he himself who speaks when the Holy Scriptures are read in church. That is why readers are asked to prepare for their role at Mass. That is why it's such an important role. That is why those who minister at Mass are asked to dress appropriately, to reflect the reverence and importance of what they do. If we look at our Gospel reading today, we have Jesus walking along by the Sea of Galilee, and he sees some men fishing. Only fishermen, you might think. But in those days, the fish from the Sea of Galilee were regarded as a delicacy, and they were exported back to Rome. So those fishermen not only fished for their catch, but they also had to take it to market. They had to be sellers, they had to be bargainers, they had to be much more than just fishermen, as well as being able to mend their nets. So they weren't uneducated men in that respect. They were men of the world. And just imagine the presence that our Lord had, how awesome it was that he could persuade men just to drop everything and follow him. I've never met anyone like that, and I doubt that anyone of you have. Each time we come to church or listen to a passage from Scripture or read a passage, God is speaking to each one of us. We need to ask ourselves each time, what is God saying to me? If we don't do that, then we're not actively listening. And we don't actively listen, then we cannot be surprised if we don't hear or understand what God wants to say to us. St. Gregory once wrote, "The Bible is a love letter sent by God to his people, in which we can perceive the heart of God." It might surprise you to know that Lent starts on the 14th of February, just over 3 weeks away. So why not prepare for it now and start planning to read God's love letter to you for 5 minutes every day in Lent? Start with the Gospels and ask yourself, what is God saying to me? You might think of using Lectio Divina, divine reading, which is an old monastic, simple way of reading and praying, which has four simple steps. Read, meditate, pray, and contemplate. What did God say to you today in the Gospel?
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only God, the Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial of the Father,
for the church in our little Brighton, called to prayer, formation and mission. May all parishioners have a deeper understanding of scripture and tradition. Lord, in your mercy. For the Episcopal Vicar for pastoral planning and his implementation team. May their engagement with parish communities be spiritually fruitful. Lord, in your mercy. For those whom the Lord calls as priests, deacons and religious. May they have the courage to leave aside their nets and follow the Lord. Lord, in your mercy. For the unity of all Christians, called to proclaim the good news from God. May the Church of Christ speak with a unified voice on issues that affect our society. Lord, in your mercy. For the sick, the housebound, the bereaved, the lonely, and all those in need. May they find in this community the support needed to carry their cross. Lord, in your mercy. For the faithful departed and those with anniversaries at this time. May the Lord accept our prayers and offerings for the repose of their souls. Lord, in your mercy. May Our Lady, Help of Christians, pray for us and with us as we say, Hail Mary,
full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now and at the hour of our death. Amen.
In a moment of silence, we pray for our own needs and intentions.
Almighty Father, we direct our actions according to your good pleasure, and so we ask you to hear and answer our prayers through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Thank you. pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice and gave you thanks, gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." Saviour's command and formed by divine teaching.
Shalom, the sign of peace.
Thank you. Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that receiving the grace by which you bring us to new life, we may always glory in your gift through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
So as always, there's some limited number of printed newsletters available intended for those who don't have access to the online newsletter. The second Dora's Hiring Collection is for SPUC, the Society for the Protection of the Unborn Child. And if you're using the card reader, please select the second collection option. Being a third-party collection is not gift-aidable. This afternoon at 4 p.m. in St. Mark's Church in Little Common, there is the Bexhill Church Together service for the unity of Christians. So that's 4 p.m. in St. Mark's Church here in Little Common. On Wednesday this week at 11 a.m. in St. Martha's Hall, there's the Three Churches Together in Little Common meeting, which will also pray for the unity of Christians. I'm going away for a week, so I return to celebrate the evening mass on Thursday, the 1st of February. Next weekend, the parish welcomes Father Paul Jennings to supply the Sunday masses. The Lord be with you.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go and announce the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.